Yes,
Yes,
sir.
sir.
Audible. Yeah.
It's my immense pleasure to introduce today's chief guest, Professor K. Marimuthu. Professor K. Marimuthu is working at Department of Biotechnology, Faculty of Applied Sciences, AMIST University, AIIMS University, Malaysia. He has obtained BSc Zoology in 1995, MSc Environmental Biotechnology in 1997, PhD Zoology in the year of 2003. And MBA in the year of 2015 from Mananmaniyam Sundaranar University, Tirunelveli, Tamil Nadu. He has cleared ICAR NET in the year of 2001. He is having 15 years of teaching experience and held various positions, especially Deputy Vice Chancellor for Academic and International Affairs, AIIMS University, Malaysia. He had experience in research as DST JRF in the year 1998 to 2000, ICAR SRF in the year 2001, a DBT project instructor in the year 2002 to 2003, postdoctoral fellow in the year 2003 to 5 at University of Science, Malaysia. His research specializations are toxic effects of pollution in fishes, breeding and culture of leech, fish immunology and immunomodulators in aquaculture, nutritional requirements of freshwater fishes and larval rearing of air-breathing fishes. He has mentored two PhD scholars, greater than 40 undergraduate students, four master students. He has published 97 research articles in international and national journals, 10 articles in popular magazines and bulletin, presented research findings in 40 conferences and seminars, published two books and proceedings, and six chapters in conference proceedings. He has received research grant RM 820,300 as investigator and co-investigator from Ministry of Agriculture Sciences, Malaysia, MOA Science Fund, Malaysia, AIIMS University Grant Knowledge Transfer Program to University Putra, Malaysia, and Fundamental Research Grant, Malaysia. He is an editorial board member in Indian Journal of Natural Products and Resources and the International Journal of Lithology and Fisheries, editor-in-chief, Journal of Adelan Agriculture. He is a life member in National Academy of Biological Sciences, India, and a member in Asian Fisheries Society. He has been visited China, Singapore, Taiwan, Indonesia, Sri Lanka, and Thailand for research as well as the academic purpose. With this brief introduction, I am welcome today's chief guest on behalf of KSR College of Technology Management, the HOD, and the National Science Foundation. I am welcome you, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
I'll hand over the session to Professor Marimuthu.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir, for the nice introduction and a very broad introduction. I didn't expect. Okay, right. Thank you, Dr. Maithili and Dr. Rajalakshmi, for inviting me for this 21 days session on FTP session. So happy to be present my topic on application of statistics and research for this today's session. I hope participants, can you all hear me? Is that audible? Participants, can you all hear me?
Yes, audible.
Oh, right.
Audible.
Yeah, fine.
Yes, sir, audible.
So in my presentation, I'm going to cover this or the area. It is going to be a lengthy topic. I hope you all can listen. It's going to be more around 2 hours session. In between, if you all wish, we can have a 5 to 10 minutes break. And I would say statistics actually is a very, very dry subject. Now, if you love statistics, then you feel more easy. Okay, all right. So many of the biological researchers, we hate mathematics, we hate statistics, but always we seek assistance from the statistician for analyzing our data. Majority of the biological sciences researchers, we look for someone for helping us to analyze the data. Do you agree with me? Yes, right? Yeah. So today my presentation, I'm going to cover what is research and the research process and what are the motivation behind conducting a research in all the field and why do you need to have a statistical knowledge in research, academic research, and what do you mean by biostatistics and what are the types of biostatistics, the terms related to biostatistics, different types of variables and different types of data, scales of measurement. And these are all very, very important for choosing a particular statistical method. and types of sampling, sampling methods, and what do you mean by observational studies, what do you mean by experimental research, and then how to present and describe your setup data, for example, table and graphical presentation and its advantages. And then a little bit I will cover about the measure of central tendency, measure of dispersion, and what are the measure of central tendency and what are the measure of dispersion. And then little bit cover about when and how to use some of the basic statistical analysis like a t-test, comparison means, chi-square, correlation, regression, ANOVA, and then when we can use it non-parametric statistical methods. I am very sure all the participants today this session, definitely you would have studied and would have acquired a statistical knowledge in your undergraduate and postgraduate, and some of you may be experienced in the statistics. Okay. But I would like to start from the beginning so that we can understand. So audience, I would like to know how many are from biological sciences? Anything can, how many are from?
There are only few people from biological sciences. Actually, it's a diverse
people. Oh, diverse people. Okay, fine. No problem. So I'm going to cover generally.
Slide is not visible.
Who's audio? My audio is not visible, ma'am.
Slide is not visible, sir.
Okay, Dr. Maithili, can you see my slide?
No, sir.
Not right now.
Okay, I have covered it. How come? I have shared my screen.
No, sir, not visible.
You are okay. You came back. You please try once again, sir. Give the share option and then you.
How about now?
Yes, sir, we can see the first.
All right, can you see the screen now?
Yes, sir.
So these are the area I'm going to cover for this today topic.
Sir, we could see the next slide.
Second, ma'am.
Now it's the first slide.
This is the first slide now, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I request all the participants to put your audio in a mute mode so that everyone can listen and carefully, right? And we should not disturb others' flow. Yeah, I hope you all can understand, right? So please put your audio in the mute mode so that easy, without any interruption, we can carry on the today's session. Okay, so these are the topic and the areas I'm going to cover. What is research, a research process, and motivation in conducting a research? Why do we need to have a statistical knowledge? What do you mean by biostatistics? What do you different types of statistics? The terms related to biostatistics.
Sir?
Yeah, ma'am.
Sir, you are in the first slide itself. That is application of statistics in research.
Why, ma'am? It's not moving. Is that fine?
No, it is not yet.
How come?
Sir,
can
you in screen, full screen mode, sir?
Yes, ma'am. Full screen mode.
Sir, I think it's not moving that. You better escape from full screen mode, sir.
Okay.
Now you choose the second slide, sir. Yes, sir. We can see the second slide right now.
Okay. Do you want me to go for a screen full slide?
No, sir. I think your voice is not supporting. That's okay, sir. You just please increase the size of this thing, sir. At the bottom you have. Yes, sir. Yes. Yes, sir. Enough, sir.
Is that fine? Okay.
Yes, sir. Fine.
Okay. So my voice is audible? And can you see the slide?
Yes, sir, you are audible. Yes, okay. Sir, we can see this slide. Thank you.
Okay. So these are the outline for the today presentation. What is research? A research process, motivation in conducting a research. And why do we need to have a statistical knowledge, biostatistics and types? The terms related to biostatistics and types of variables, types of data, the different scales of measurement. And then a little bit cover about sampling and sampling methods. And then what do you mean by observational studies? What do you mean by experimental research? How to present and set up a data like a table and graph? I'm also a little bit cover about the measure of central tendency and measure of dispersion. Then finally with when and how to use some of the basic analysis like comparison means, t-test, when to use chi-square, when to use correlation, regression, ANOVA. And little bit I'll cover about some of the non-parametric statistical method like Mann-Whitney, Wilcoxon, Kriskal-Wallis, and Friedman, etc. Okay, so this session is going to be a lengthy session. So let us see how fast we can, So in between, if you can't make it, understand any particular topic, you can ask me, you can stop me anytime. So with that, we can move on. Okay, so I request all the participants put your audio in a mute mode. So we all know that research is a systematized effort to gain a new knowledge, looking for a new knowledge. Okay, systematic process of collecting, organizing, analyzing the information or data in order to increase our understanding of the phenomenon about which we are concerned or interested. The topic has got societal value, the topic has got any financial value, the topic has got some kind of improvement in, so in the environment and so on. So looking for a drug, right? Looking for a new device, looking for new knowledge, a new system. So for that, we go for a research. And what are the motivation? Why do we need to do research? What are the motivation behind conducting a research? And we all know that PhD is a tertiary education, whereby PhD is a compulsory component, whereby research is a compulsory component. And when you have PhD, you have consequential benefits like the salary, promotions, all comes together with a PhD. And then other than that, there are a lot of challenges we are facing today, right? For example, controlling this pandemic, COVID-19. Globally, we have a problem for controlling a mosquito. Globally, there is a shortage of fuel. Globally, there is a looking for biofuels, right? And there is a lot of pollution and controlling of plastics. So these kind of areas have initiates. These are challenges. These are all problems initiate research. And then, so when you do your research, there is a happiness inside. When you do your research, there is an intellectual joy of doing a research, uncomparable satisfaction. So for example, you are a PhD scholar, first time you do a research, right? And the first time when you conduct a study, you have got your expected outcome, expected results, or first time you got your paper published in a journal, really the happiness is uncomparable. Okay, right. So there is a joy, happiness when you do research, and then there is a service to the society. Any research has got societal value, that particular topic has got more merit and more opportunity for getting a funding. Example, biofuel, bioplastics, and control of mosquitoes, and anything related to healthcare, right? And looking for any natural products. So these all areas definitely always will have a good merit, and there is a possibility of getting funding in different funding agency. So whatever the research you do, think about what could be the societal value in that, even business, in any field, financial aspects, whatever field, just incorporate some societal value in that project. So the possibility of getting a funding, easy, right? Yeah. So research process, usually we do research starting with, there are different ways. Sometimes supervisor will have a project. Right, PhD supervisor will have a project funded by the different government, a different body, and accordingly they advertise in a newspaper or in a media and look for a suitable and relevant candidate to carry on the research in that project. So another approach, student will look for a research supervisor. Student will have some idea and some basic knowledge in that field, and with that the student would like to continue a PhD, and he look for a research laboratory, he look for universities or foreign university or within the country, and the student also will have look at the facilities are available, right? Before joining the PhD, now what is it happening? They will discuss with the supervisor. Accordingly, they draft the research proposal and go for a PhD. So whatever the approach we do research, first of all, we have to look for a nice area in that. And then we have to define the problem. What is the research problem, right? And then we have to look for review of literature. What is available for the particular topic you have chosen, the problem you have chosen, and what is lacking? That is very important as a researcher. What is lacking, right? So with that, that is your strong strength and that is your strong point, lacking. So with that, you can fine-tune your hypothesis, formulate your hypothesis. And based on your hypothesis and your objectives, you design your experiment, conduct the study, collect the data, whereby statistical component comes in, right? Analyze the data. And then you look for whether are we supporting the hypothesis or do we have enough evidence to support the hypothesis, or we do not have enough evidence to support the hypothesis, and interpret the results and go for a report submission. Report submission, meaning to say that you go for a report submission for funding agency, or you go for a research publication, and with that you also can get your PhD degree. Okay, so this is a process. So whereby the statistical component very, very important. Being a researcher, being an academician, so statistics is very, very vital. And whether you like it or not, statistics is a very, very important field. Without statistics, you cannot do any the research. So when you go for research publications, or when you go for any conference presentation, or when you go for a PhD Viva was examination, majority questions will be related to your experimental designs and the statistics you have used it and interpretations, right? And many of the scholars will have a difficulty and they lose the confidence while presenting the research findings in a conference or in any forum or a public Viva was examination, right? So very, very important. So if you have good knowledge in statistics, you can defend with full confidence and with full motivation, with full encouragement, right? Very, very important. So why statistics? Yeah, strong background in statistics essential for any researchers in all scientific field. For example, to design experiment, to conduct a survey related research, to analyze the data, and then interpret the finding accurately, right? So when you submit for a research publication for any journal, the reviewer, the editorial, they look at your methodology, whether you have used appropriate statistical method for presenting your interpretation, right? So this will give you some kind of first impression and the quality of your paper, quality of your research you have done. So why do we need to have a statistical knowledge in research? For example, when you read a research manuscript, we used to have a habit of reading a manuscript published by others in your similar field or different field. So when you read a manuscript introduction, you read happily, at least you'll understand. When you move on your materials and methods section, you somehow you can understand. So when you move on your last paragraph, your materials and method, whereby they incorporate one paragraph called statistical analysis or data analysis. So usually the thesis they do write elaborately, whereas the research manuscript they write very precisely, very concisely, right? So where they use some kind of statistical terms and terminology, right? A particular statistical test, whereby majority of the scholars, majority of the researchers, we do get confusion why they have used it and how they have used it, right? Very, very important. Sometimes they use kind of p-value, significance, statistically significant, whereby many of the scholars, they do have a confusion and whereby they lose the interest to continue reading the full manuscript, okay? So with the statistical knowledge, you can read, you understand your the research findings, how others they have done it, and also will help you to design your own experimental projects. You can design your own experimental projects. You can analyze your own results. Definitely, you all have a more positive motivation and a positive confidence on presenting your findings. And also, when you have a good statistical knowledge, you can play with your data. You can play with your data. Definitely, majority of the scholars in India, they do a lot of good research. So without proper statistical test, lack of statistical knowledge, they do tend to publish the research article in a regional journals. Okay, I hope majority you can agree with me, right? So this is very, very common. And most of the time the scholars, we do research, but the statistical part, we look for someone else to analyze it, okay? Sometimes they will analyze and give you the output, then you need to interpret. But if you know the statistical knowledge, if you use your own statistical tool to analyze, then you can interpret very well when compared to someone else helping you. Okay, yeah. So there are two main areas of statistics, mathematical statistics and applied statistics. Mathematical statistics, mathematician, they develop different method. For example, you would have seen Fisher exact test, Pearson correlation, right? T-test. This all comes with some names of authors, mathematician. So those who have developed a methodology, a method. And another one is called applied statistics. whereby biological sciences business business people as academician, we use those method for our research data analysis. So this is called applied statistics. Okay, so applied statistics used in all field, right? For example, medical sciences, health sciences, business, psychology, arts and sciences, right? Public health. So statistical concepts are similar in all the field. Whereas when you look at the examples in different field, there will be different. When you look at any curriculum in undergraduate and postgraduate, statistics is one of the important component in the curriculum. You look at anything, any aspects. For example, law degree, psychology, arts and sciences, right? Even recently I had a workshop in Chennai. Few participants, they came from Tamil. Few participants, they joined in the workshop, statistical workshop. They were from specialized in Tamil, specialized in English literature, right? So then I was asked how this will be useful. So look at here, the research is important and the statistics is very, very important for all the field, not only in biological sciences, it is important for all the field. Okay, so what do you mean by biostatistics? Statistics used in biological sciences, life sciences is called biostatistics. Business students, they study business statistics. Medical people, they look at medical statistics. Right, there are different, but concepts are similar, definitions are similar. Only thing is they look at the examples, look at the scenario, situations, case studies will be different from all the field. Is that fine so far? Is that fine so far, participant? You get me?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, yeah. Fine. Yeah. So statistics used in biological sciences is called biostatistics. Even statistics also called biometry, and has got a variety of application in all the field, including human biology, life sciences, medicine, public health, business, etc. Then we move on with some of the terminology very commonly used in biostatistics. And what do you mean by population? What do you mean by sample? Population actually is a whole. Example, the rate of obesity in India, the rate of prevalence of COVID-19. In whole India or whole Tamil Nadu. So whole Tamil Nadu actually is a population. The percentage of people who have infected with COVID-19 and has got mortality. The death rate in Tamil Nadu, the death rate in Karnataka regarding the infection of COVID-19. And then one more question, the smoking habits of Indian population, the smoking habits of Indian population. How much percentage of people on average they do smoke in India or in Tamil Nadu? Or birth weight of baby in India, birth weight of baby in Tamil Nadu, or birth weight of newborn baby in particular district is a population. So it's a kind of broader picture, right? Population means it's a whole thing, complete collection of all the elements. But very often we don't go for a population to look for. To study about the population, we look for a sample, right? So population is not relevant and also time consuming, so tedious. More manpower is required, right? And sometimes population you cannot reach. Can we reach the shark available in the ocean? Can we know how many sharks are available in the ocean? Or how many trees are available in the forest? We do not know, right? Do we know how much microorganisms are present in our body? Right? Very difficult. So for that reason, we go for a fecal sample. To study about the microbial diversity, right? We do some kind of field study. We collect a sample. Sample means a portion of the population for the study. With that sample, we study about the population. And sample is very important. How precise your sample is estimating your population. Okay. For example, birth weight of 100 baby born in a particular hospital. So with that, you can study about the whole district. With that, you can study about the whole Tamil Nadu. With that, you can study about the Indian population. Okay, the sample should be kind of reliable. The sample size should be reliable and precise to estimate the population. So then we move on with the parameter and statistics. Numerical characteristics of the whole population is called parameter. Meaning to say that your population mean, population standard deviation, population variance, your correlation coefficient. These are called parameter. And numerical characteristics of a sample is called statistics. Your sample mean, your sample standard deviation, sample variance, sample correlation coefficient, commonly called statistic. You need to remember parameter and statistics. Then we move on with the variable and data. Variable actually is a measure of property or attribute associated with each subject. For example, you are conducting a survey, the smoking habits in Tamil, smoking habits and what they call lung cancer infection. This is what you're going to study, for example, right? So what are the information normally you collect? You collect male and female, right? What is their age? And what is their body weight? How many cigarettes per day you consume? And do you have any kind of lung infection related symptoms? So each question I asked pertaining to the subject is called variable. Property, attribute I have asked in the questionnaire or collect the data is called variable. Age is a variable. Do you smoke, yes or no, is a variable. How many cigarettes per day smoke is a variable. And do you have any kind of symptoms related to lung infection, yes or no, is a variable. Okay, and also blood group, your age, body weight, height, these all examples of variable. Whatever you are interested in measuring, the subjects or animals, experimental animals, is called variable. Right? And another question is in the population level and the what you call the government services. The services provided by the government, especially this house. You are with the speaker. How do you, what is the satisfaction level pertaining to this current scenario regarding your treatment, regarding your facilities, how governments are supporting for your day-to-day life, including electricity, your day-to-day income, right? The facilities given by the government, right? So these all you can think about it, how you can conduct. And each one related to that is called variable. So then we move on with the data. Data means whatever observations you have collected. Some it comes with qualitative form, some it comes with quantitative form, right? What is your family income? It's a kind of quantitative, right? And do you male or female, gender, and do you smoke, yes or no? It's a kind of qualitative. Do you smoke, yes or no? It's a qualitative, right? Survey responses or demographic details. Is that right? And sometimes you ask how many children in your family. It's a quantitative, right? So data. So there are different types of variables. I told you there are qualitative, categorical variable, and another one is called numerical variable. Categorical variable, qualitative variable, also called qualitative data or categorical data. Example, have you got married, yes or no? What is your race? And are you male or female? These all defined categories, qualitative. Look at the quality of the subject. Categorical variable or qualitative data. The outcome is called the categorical data or qualitative data. So another type of variable is called numerical or quantitative. And it comes two types. Quantitative, it comes two types, discrete and continuous. Discrete means whole number. Remember, how many text messages since morning you have received? How many mobile phone you have? Right? How many mobile phone you have? Number of children in your family. So these are examples of discrete, whereby we use the whole number. We don't say my house has got four children or 4.5 children, or my family has got 4.5 family members. We don't specify. We specify the whole number. That is called discrete. The continuous variable, what is your age, what is your height, what is your weight, and how much electricity you have spent for the last 2 months, how much electricity bill you have paid for it, and what is your last month's salary. These are examples of continuous. We'll have decimal points, we'll have decimal values, and these are all called measured characteristics. It's a discrete counting process, and continuous actually is a measurement. We use some kind of device to measure the continuous variable, continuous data. Whereas here we use some kind of counting process. The question will be how many children you have, how many messages you have received. It comes with the question starting with, whereas a continuous measurement process, the question will be with how much your weight, how much electricity, how much your body weight, etc. I hope you all can understand how to define the categorical and numerical variable. Numerical variable, there are two types, discrete and continuous. I have given you some of the examples. So these are all very, very important. What type of data you are dealing with, what type of variables you are dealing with. So this will dictate you, this will guide you, this will help you to choose appropriate statistical method in your the research. Okay, these are all very, very basic. We must know as a researcher, as an academician, what type of scales of measurement, what type of variables we are handling with, and what type of variables you are dealing with in your the research. So categorical variable, otherwise also known as a nominal variable. We can call them as a nominal scales of variable. Example, what is your blood group? What is your gender? Which race you belong to? And what is your favorite color? Which bank you have your account? Whether you have account in the private bank or whether you have account in the what you call public bank, government. These are all examples of categorical. So another type of variable is called ordinal variable. Ordinal variable, we can call them as a Likert scale. So how do you rate the quality of session conducted by Dr. Marimuthu? How do you rate 1 to 5? And how do you rate the overall, the 21-day session was conducted by Nitisans Foundation and the rate the quality of the program, quality of the content offered, quality of the review 1 to 5. And another example, how do you rate your body pain? When you go to hospital, doctor will ask you whether you have mild pain or moderate pain or severe pain, right? This all comes under ordinal. Running what you call sports event, first position, second position, third position, it's a kind of ranked data or ordinal variable. Quality of the meet. Sometimes you ask questions like this. Taxation in India is very high. This is what you, for example, if you study like this, taxation in India is very high. You collect or conduct a study in Indian population. So the options are 5 options. Strongly agree, agree, neutral, and disagree, and strongly disagree. So this can be related with the annual income, or the salary, and people working in the private sector, people working in the government sector, right? And depends. People are getting high salary, they may feel taxation very high. And people having agricultural income, they don't feel, they don't have even filed the tax. So for them, they don't feel much tax burden. Okay, so these are some of the examples of ordinal variable or ordinal data. So quantitative qualitative variable, I have covered. I will skip this slide. And then we move on with the independent variable and dependent variable. In experimental research, one variable we do manipulate, one variable we do control. And we used to call them as experimental variable or independent variable. Variable you do control, the variable you do manipulate, and the variable you do adjust is called independent variable. And dependent variable actually is the effect of independent variable. Dependent variable actually is a measured variable, is an outcome variable, and dependent variable are the influence of independent variable. For example, you are conducting a study on effect of temperature on the hatching rate of fish eggs or poultry egg. So independent variable here, we manipulate the temperature, right? We adjust, we modify the temperature in the laboratory condition. So this is your independent variable. And outcome variable, how does your independent variable affect your dependent variable? For example, another example I'm giving you, you collect advertisement expenses in different companies. For the last 1 year, how much money you have spent for advertisement, right? And what was your revenue for the last year? So like that, you collect the data for 100 companies. Okay, now you tell me what is your independent, what is your dependent. Your sales will be depending on advertisement, right? How much quantity of advertisement or how much money you have spent for advertisement. So this will affect your sales, this will affect your overall revenue. So definitely not only the advertisement will affect, and how the reputation also important, reputation of the company also very important. Yeah, the faith customer you have in your company also very important. So in a study, there is another variable is called extraneous variable, right? So I have told you one example, advertisement versus sales. So how much money you have spent for last year advertisement, and what was your revenue, what how much was your sales for the last year? So do you think only advertisement will affect your sales? Do you think advertisement only will affect your revenue? No, there are several factors will affect your revenue. So the several factors are called extraneous variable. The several factors are called extraneous variable. Sometimes we know that we don't include them in the study, but sometimes if you suspect this variable definitely will affect your dependent variable, we can include them. Right, they are called extraneous variable. Okay, so independent variable that are irrelevant to the focus of the study, it may affect your prediction, it may affect your dependent variable and interpretation of your results. Extraneous variable, I'm giving you an example for extraneous variable, how you can easily understand. So when you go to any supermarket, when you go to any for shopping mall, when you go to any production facility or Amazon or what you call Flipkart, right, whereby people they get order from the online, right, order from the online, and based on that order the people in the production line, they'll go for a packing, the packing as well as the pasting the address and all to deliver the products. Okay, so you would have observed in the supermarket any kind of working facilities, there'll be mild music will be playing. Right, sometimes will be noisy, sometimes will be very pleasant. So one researcher conducted while having their music in a production facility, does it affect the productivity of the staff? While playing their music, does it affect the productivity of the staff? Productivity means in the packing process, how much task, how much parcel they have delivered per day from morning 9 o'clock to until 5 o'clock, 8 hours duty in the shift. How much product they have packed, how much product they have delivered particular day. So while having the music, does it affect the productivity? So how do you conduct? So my independent variable actually is a music. My independent variable actually is a music. What is a dependent variable? Tell me any participant, you can unmute and talk. You can unmute and talk, anyone?
Productivity.
A productivity, task performance actually is the outcome variable, dependent variable. So do you think only music will affect the productivity of a staff? There are some other factors. There are some other factor may affect the task performance. So those variables are called extraneous variables. For example, what I do, I'm going to have two group of people in a production packing facility. I recruit 100 people, right? 100 people, I randomly split them into two group. One group, I give them music and ask them to perform the task. Another 50 members, I'll give them with the music, I'll ask them to do the task and monitor how much they do it on average. So does music affect, or is there any relationship music versus and the task performance, right? So what is your opinion? Do you think the facility music will affect the productivity, or music will enhance, increase the productivity? It depends. Depends again the nature of the employees and the 50 participants you have included for the control group, the 50 participants you have included in your experimental group or treatment group with the music, we need to assign them same age group, 50% male, 50% female. And sometimes, you know, tiredness also very factor, and time of the day you conduct the study also important. So these are called extraneous variable. And again, what type of music you're going to play and volume of the music you are going to, whether the study conducted in the morning hour or in the afternoon hours or in the evening hours. Okay, so these are called extraneous variable. Is that fine so far? Extraneous variable, you all can understand. Participant, did you get me? The extraneous variable, is that fine to follow? Extraneous variable?
Fine, sir.
Okay, fine.
Yes.
All right. So then we move on with the confounding variable. And extraneous variables are independent variable, may affect the productivity or the your dependent variable. Confounding variable is associated with a factor, associated with your independent variable, affect the response. Confounding variable or extraneous variable. Confounding variables are extraneous variable. We can't tell whether they affect the task performance. We see is caused by only music, or by the confounding variable, or by both working together. Right? There are several factors. Age factor also one important. Gender also will be important. And the time of the day, the study you conduct also very, very important. So as a researcher, we try to minimize as much as possible to select the sample. Select the sample. Uniform size, we can allocate equal male and female, or we conduct the study in the same time, but still same music, same volume, but still there are some factor may affect the outcome. So what we need to do, then you can include them. You can include them, confounding variable in that, then you study about it. And then we can look at how much the task performance can be influenced by music, can be influenced by age, can be influenced by gender. Is there any gender differences? This all can be looked at. So this kind of study, when you include some confounding variable in that, you can elaborate, you can discuss your results more elaborately, more significantly, statistically. Is that all right? So confounding variable. So data comes in different forms, scale and categorical. Little bit we have discussed numerical and categorical. Numerical means scale data. Numerical means quantitative scale data. And then categorical is a kind of questionnaire based, Likert scale, yes or no, male, female, body pain, right? These all comes under categorical, okay? So scale variable, there are two type, continuous and discrete. Continuous and discrete. So continuous, I have mentioned already, will have a decimal values. Discrete will have a whole number. Remember, continuous variable, example, your height and weight, your hemoglobin, your body glucose, your cholesterol, example of continuous. Number of children you have in your family is a discrete, whole number, right? Yeah. So types of data, quantitative, there are two types, discrete and continuous. Discrete will have a decimal, sorry, whole number. Continuous will have a decimal values. So discrete counting process involved. The research question will be how many text messages, how many bacterial colony, how many children you have in your family, how many phone calls you have received since morning 6 o'clock, right? How many emails you have received? Normally we specify the whole number. Is that fine? How many friends you have, or how many contacts you have in your WhatsApp? How many students in your class? These are examples of discrete, whole number. So continuous is a measurement process. The research question will be how much? What is your body cholesterol? What is your body weight? What is your height? Do you think exactly you'll be 70 kg or 75 kg? No, your body weight will be 75 kilo. 585 grams and milligrams. Do you think exactly you have a same quantity of cholesterol? There will be a decimal values, glucose, etc. So now you tell me to assess the understanding so far. Maybe you can all unmute and then you tell me the questions related. I will ask one by one to tell me whether these are discrete or continuous, and you need to state why. Tell me, voltage of electricity in a power line, is it a discrete or continuous?
Continuous.
Fantastic. Continuous. So number of eggs laid by the hens or chicken?
Discrete.
Discrete.
Okay. The time the student takes to complete the exam. The time
continuous.
Your family income, graduate student income. After graduation?
Continuous.
Family income, continuous. Maybe this is the next question. Biological researchers can respond to me. Participants from biological science. The number of colony in a petri plate. You count. Counting process.
Discrete.
Well, sometimes we measure the solution in a spectrophotometer. OD measurement.
Continuous.
Fantastic.
Continuous.
Okay. Yeah. So these are all very, very important. These are all very, very important while defining your statistical test. So each type of variable, a specific statistical test are available. You are dealing with the nominal, you are dealing with the continuous, you are dealing with the discrete, you are dealing with the continuous data. That is a separate procedure, separate statistical test. Okay. Yeah. And even graphical presentation also vary. So then we move on with, there are four scales of measurement. So this is to further define your variable. So what are the four scales of measurement? Nominal scale, ordinal scale, interval scale, and ratio scale. Nominal scale means it's a qualitative, gender, male and female. Okay, have you got married? Do you smoke, yes or no? Do you have diabetic or are you hypertension? So these are called nominal variable, yes or no, right? Nominal, just we look at the quality of the subject. With that, how many male, how many female, how many are smoking, how many are got married, how much percentage of the people not married, nominal. And then next variable is called ordinal. Next one is called measurement is called ordinal. Ordinal means it's a kind of ranked data. You are a designation, are you a lecturer, are you a, this is all ordinal. How do you rate the quality of the today's session, 1 to 5? How do you rate the taxation in the country, 1 to 5? Very high and very low. How do you rate my today delivery of the class, poor to excellent? Yeah, ordinal. So when you go to hospital, doctor will ask you, do you have mild pain, moderate pain, severe pain, are examples of ordinal. Then you are a student grade, A grade, B grade, C grade, D grade, fail, these are all examples of ordinal. And then this is called non-parametric. Nominal and ordinal, we can call them non-parametric. The scales of measurement is called non-parametric. At this moment, you remember nominal, ordinal, or non-parametric. While we move on further, I will explain further on the non-parametric. Okay. So interval and ratio, they are called numerical. Interval, ratio are called numerical. So I will explain. Interval means there won't be any starting point. For example, temperature. Even 0 degrees Celsius also, you feel the temperature. When you go to Ooty, Kodaikanal, there will be sometimes minus degree Celsius. Darjeeling, Delhi, you feel negative degree Celsius. Still, you feel the temperature, right? So some variable, this kind of interval, we record as it is. Sometimes when you go for competitive examination, whereby there will be some kind of negative marks, entrance examination. So every two wrong answer, one mark will be minus. Sometimes some students will get 0 marks, some student will get negative marks. So we can call them. So those kind of situation, the marks, we can call them interval. Negative also will give meaning. 0 also will give meaning. And then we move on further. Ratio scales are measurement. Ratio means starting point is a 0. So there is no any such negative. Starting point is 0. From then the value starts. Example, your height, your weight, right? Your cholesterol. Anyone will have a 0 cholesterol? Anyone will have 0 cholesterol? No. Anyone will have a 0 glucose? No. So these variables are called ratio scales of measurement. Is that fine? So handling with the nominal, handling with the ordinal, handling with the interval, handling with the ratio, and there are different graphical methods are involved. Different descriptive statistical measure for nominal, ordinal, interval, ratio are different, right? The graphical method also for presenting this nominal, ordinal, and interval ratio also very, very important, also vary. So we have to use appropriate graphical method for presenting nominal scales of measurement data, ordinal scales of measurement data, interval scales of measurement data, and ratio, and we have to use appropriate statistical method. So remember, nominal, ordinal scales are known as non-parametric, and then interval ratio scales are known as a scale variable or parametric data. We can go for a, so there are two types of statistics, parametric statistics, non-parametric statistics in your inferential statistics. Inferential statistics. Okay. Yeah. So nominal actually is observations, gender, marital status, smoking, yes or no. So property of the nominal, just we look at how many male participants are registered for this session, how many female participants have registered. And then you go for one more question, how many participants for this today's session have come from business, have come from pharmaceutical, health sciences, have come from biological sciences, medical sciences, you classify them, right? For some kind of classification purpose, coding purpose, we go for asking these questions. Nominal doesn't mean that male and female, there is a difference. Just we look at the quality of the subjects. Among the participants, how many they got married, yes or no? So with that, we can specify that there were 110 participants who have enrolled, of which 60 participants have got married, and 50 participants have not married. And also you can specify percentage wise. Okay, smoking status, yes or no? Among this much percentage, they do have the smoking habit. This much percentage, they do not smoke. Okay, so it doesn't mean that male is greater than female or female is greater than male. So just for a classification, we look at the count and then we present. So ordinal actually is a ranked data. You are a student grade, your pain rating, Likert scale, strongly agree to, strongly disagree, or spice, hottest. And then for example, rating a product, for example, you have some kind of new product, edible product, you ask the children. For example, you prepare a kind of bread or any kind of new biscuits you are going to introduce in the market, you ask the opinion. How do you rate the taste, crunchiness of the product? Okay, 1 to 5. So ranked data, ordinal data. So recording ordinal data for statistical purpose, we go for 1 to 3. Full professor, associate professor, assistant professor. When satisfaction score, satisfied, dissatisfied, extremely satisfied, and neutral. And how happy are you with your manager? How happy are you with working in a organization? How happy are you with working in a private university? How happy are you working in a government sector, government university, right? So people working in a government university, they'll be very happy in India. And people working in a private university will have a tough task, tough time, right? So competition will be there, more workload will be there, happiness. So these all can be measured by like asking these questions, extremely happy to extremely unhappy. Or you ask same thing you ask them in a male and female, people working in a government sector. So how happy are you with working? You compare male and female happiness. Do you think male and female will have same happiness? Right? Do you think male and female working in the government private sector will have same happiness? The happiness vary from male and female, definitely. So male, they have to face a lot of problems. They have physiological problems, right? And also traveling and other, their health, etc. Right? So comparatively, so there will be a difference. And also people working in the government sector, people working in the private sector, and people working in a private bank, people working in a government bank, you can check for, you can look for their happiness like this. Okay. So these are examples of ordinal data. You can code for statistical purpose. We used to code them 1 to 5. Extremely happy means we go for 5, and extremely unhappy means we go for 1. Or same thing, you ask your student. Let's say you have a 5,000 student in your campus. How happy are you with the facilities are available on the campus? 1 to 5. How happy are you with? Or 1 to 10, you ask them. Rate the facilities given in the laboratory or facilities available for the sports facilities, available for the students, or other recreation facilities available, or the classroom facilities. How do you rate 1 to 10? If anything less than 5 rating scale, very poor, dissatisfied. Anything more than 5 on average, we can specify them as okay with. We are providing the good facilities. So if on and off, we can conduct this kind of survey among the students so that you can improve the quality of the facilities. So that our student actually is very, very important. Student satisfaction is very, very important, especially the private sector. Nowadays, education become a very business, right? You agree with me? So if you meet the quality and expectation of the students, you will have a good reputation, right? And if not, you have to go for a lot of advertisement and a lot of campaign for participating in the market and promoting your university, promoting your programs, right? Too many colleges offering similar programs. So education become a business and also very tough task and competition globally. Yeah. So interval scale is a quantitative data. Interval scale actually is a quantitative data. Example, temperature. 0 degrees Celsius also we feel the temperature. Negative degree Celsius also we'll feel the temperature. So there is no any starting point. And there is no any starting point. And there is no any nothingness. And there is no any meaningful zero. Okay, we have the property in any point of time, we can record the temperature, right? So in that case, you can add the data, you can subtract the value, you cannot multiply, and you cannot divide the values, right? Yeah. Then ratio scales, your student score 0 to 100. So minimum mark the student can acquire obtain zero. Maximum mark the student go up to 100. Your salary, income, and how much money you have in your wallet. For example, if you don't have any money in your wallet, you feel the nothingness, right? Even rainfall, starting point is a zero, right? Rainfall starting point actually is a zero. So here, whenever you have the zero means you feel the nothingness. Zero means, for example, a student does not perform any very well for the exam and the student has secured 0 marks. So the student feels the nothingness. So remember, nominal data is meant for categorize only. Ordinal has got some category with some meaningful order. Meaning to say that a candidate has got mild pain, has got lower than the moderate pain. A candidate has facing severe pain, he is slightly higher than the medium, or he is slightly higher than the low pain. Okay, that is order. There is some order. For example, when your student's grade, right? So A grade, B grade, C grade, and F grade. Student has got D grade, he is slightly higher than the failure. And student has got A grade, he is better than A grade. You have some kind of meaningful order. But the order does not mean that the student has got A grade. You cannot say that he is 2 times better than the B grade. Do you get me? Or a candidate has having a severe pain. Doesn't mean that the candidate having severe body pain doesn't mean that he is 2 times higher than a patient has got moderate pain. Not like that. Even slight differences, the candidate will be in the other grade. For example, even student marking, when 1 mark will place them in the next higher order, or 1 mark the student will be in the fail. 40 is the pass mark. If the student has got 39, he will be in a fail. So 1 mark placed him or her in the under a fail grade. Do you get me? Or ordinal, another example in a running race. Running race, first position, second position, third position. Do you think there will be equal distances? No. Even slight differences between one candidate to the other candidate place them in the first and second position. Okay. Yeah, ordinal categorized with some meaningful order. And interval scale have got order, equal differences between categories, but no natural starting point. But there is no any natural starting point. And ratio scale, there is a differences, right? And also starting with zero, even marks starting with your body pain, sorry, your cholesterol, glucose, your RBC, WFC count, your sales, your advertisement amount you spend, are examples of ratio scales. All right, is that fine so far? So now I'm going to test your understanding on this. So now you all can unmute and tell me, what is your eye color? Tell me, what is your eye color? Whether is it a nominal, ordinal, interval, ratio? What is your eye color?
Nominal.
Nominal.
Nominal. What is your what is your gender? Are you male, female?
Female.
Nominal.
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 Okay. Okay. Rating scale: poor, good, and excellent. Poor, good, and
ordinal.
Okay, fine. Your student exam score. Student exam score 0 to 100. Ratio. Okay. Okay. So student exam score is a ratio. When you convert the student exam score into grade, is called. When you convert the student score into grade,
ordinal.
For example, salary, your family income,
ratio.
So salary also can be converted into ordinal. Low income, medium income,
high low income. And yes.
Socioeconomic status, age. Can you record the age as it is? Do you think age
ratio?
The age also you can go for, right? Ordinal. You can make them. You can go for ranking. For age, you can convert them into order, right? Less than 10 years, 10 to 20 years. You can go for a grouping, right? Ordinal, become ordinal. You need to understand. Any new ratio can be converted for ordinal. Ranking of a football team in Malaysia.
Ordinal.
Okay, what is your nationality? What is your nationality? Which country you belong to?
Ordinal.
Nominal.
Temperature.
Nominal.
Nominal.
Temperature?
Nominal.
Ordinal.
Temperature, ma'am. Temperature?
Interval.
Yeah, temperature actually is interval. And every city we have postcode, right? You tell me postcode.
Nominal
or
postcode?
Ordinal.
Nominal.
Ratio.
Nominal.
Postcode actually is a nominal. Fantastic.
Nominal.
Postcode has been given for some identification, classification.
Nominal.
Okay. So some numeral has been given, but postcode actually is a nominal. We need to consider postcode as a nominal. Okay. Your body weight. When you record your body weight as it is a ratio. When you convert whether your body ratio. Is obesity or non-obesity,
ratio then to ordinal.
We can go for ordinal. Ratio into ordinal. Okay. Body glucose.
Ratio.
Okay. Based on the presence absence of glucose, we can say that diabetic, non-diabetic. Based on the glucose,
that is nominal.
Nominal. Yes or no? Whether he has got yes or no? Right? Nominal. Yeah. So far, you are well and good. Fantastic. Okay. So can you please put your audio in a mute mode? Shall we go for a 5 minutes break? Shall we have 5 minutes break?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we have another 1 hour to go. Shall we go for a 5 minutes break?
Yes, sir.
Okay,
yes,
fine,
sir.
Fine.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. 5 minutes break. Yeah. Okay, participants, shall we continue?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Please put your audio mute mode, as there are some disturbance from the participants. Yeah, thank you. So is it possible to work out what 50 million people think by asking only 1,000 people? Okay. Sampling. So can we ask who will be the next prime minister in India by asking 1,000 people? Can we get some idea? Can we ask 1,000 people in Tamil Nadu who will be the next chief minister? Right? It's called sampling. So whole population actually, so whole people actually is a population. Tamil Nadu, whole actually is a population. With that, we do only 1,000 people, and with that 1,000, we conclude them for the future, right? So small group chosen for the study is called sample. And if you look at everyone in the whole country or whole state, it's called census. So why we need to go for a sampling? Why we need to go for a sampling? Reasons: sample can be studied very quickly and very fast, and sample is very less expensive, and sometimes entire population is impossible to reach. Example I told you, so if you are interested in studying the reproductive biology of a shark available in the ocean, but we do not know how many sharks are available. Do you know that how many cancer patients will be there in India? But there are many people will have cancer but not expressed. We can't see whether do they have a cancer or not. All right? So we do not know the full number of cases. There are maybe many cases will be there, but until they feel sickness, we don't see whether they have cancer or not. We don't diagnose it. So these are the reasons we go for a sampling, right? And the sample should be adequate to study about the population. So there are different type of sampling, and it comes with a non-probability sampling and a probability sampling. Just I will highlight what does it mean, and statistics actually is a very vast area. So covering them and application in 2 hours is not enough. So I try my level best to brief you, and this will give you some idea to choose some of the statistical tests for your research. Okay, so two type of sampling, non-probability and probability sampling. Whereby probability sampling, which involves a probability or principles to collect or select the sample. So they are simple random sampling, stratified, systematic, and cluster sampling. Okay, so non-probability, it comes with the consecutive, judgmental, convenience. Consecutive means first come first served basis. Okay, for example, you need 100 subjects, you are looking at consumer perception on a particular product. Okay, or you are looking for interested in study about the birth weight of a newborn baby in Coimbatore district. So you go to hospital, the first 100 child delivered in a particular hospital, you study them consecutively. Judgmental means based as a researcher, you have the liberty to choose, can we include the candidate in the study or not, judgmental. And again, convenience also, it comes together. It's based on your convenience, you can choose the subject for the study, nearness, locality, etc. Right. So convenience sample, for example, when you are looking at the quality of the eggs, do you look at from the bottom? Convenience means we go for the first row. Easiest way, you can look at the, collect the eggs. First rack, you look at the quality of the eggs. Consecutive means like this. You randomly check, sorry, consecutively check like this, right? And judgmental, which involves can picking from the accessible population, those individual judged most appropriate for the study. Sample numbers are chosen only on the basis of the researcher's knowledge and his judgment. Judgmental. So probability sampling actually is a kind of a lucky draw. Your lottery, simple example for lucky draw. Simple random sampling. We can use a computer program, or we can use Microsoft Excel to generate the random number. For example, an organization has got 500 employees. A researcher wants to select a sample of 100 from them. So how do you go ahead? Easiest way, in your university has got 500 employees, to appreciate randomly some people, some kind of compliments to them, give them for your 10th year or 15th year of or 25th year of anniversary of your organization. You want to give them some compliment for the lucky academic faculty members. From the 500, how do you choose the top 5 or best 5 or randomly, how do you choose? So what we need to do, we ask each candidate names and put it in the basket. We pick one or two, first 5. Or you can use a program, computer random program for Microsoft Excel to generate the sample size, right? So actually I will be offering two statistical workshop for next month. July 3 to 5 SPSS program, and 6 to 8 there is a Microsoft Excel, whereby I will cover the random number generation also and different type of statistical data analysis using Microsoft Excel and data analysis using my SPSS program. So those who are interested, you can contact me. Okay, if you are interested to look for 3 days statistics workshop, you can contact me. Okay, so later I'll give my contact number and my email, and if you're interested, you can pursue, you can come forward. So second one actually is a systematic sampling. Systematic means, let's say you have 500 candidate, of which from are going to select only the 5 candidate from the 500. So what you can do, the first 100, we have to take one number randomly. From then you say, for example, you have taken candidate number 3 in this. The next candidate should be 6th. The next candidate will be 9th one. Next candidate will be 12th one. Okay. So systematically, you select the subject for the study, or consumer or patient for the study, systematically. And then stratified sampling. Stratified means you divide the population into group. For example, based on the gender, based on the education, based on the income, based on the social class, religion, rural, urban residence, etc. For example, you study about the hemoglobin content of Tamil Nadu population. With that, in what way we can do it? Shall we go and classify them male and female? In that, we also can male and female also, we can classify them separately, less than 20 years, 20 to 40 years, 40 to 60 years, and 60 years and above, what was the hemoglobin level, right? So we do stratify, we classify them, we segregate and then study. So I'll give you an example, stratified. So research question is, assess the dietary intake of adolescents. Usually adolescents, actually the ages from 11 to 19 years. Dietary intake means how much food they consume, how much energy food they consume per day from morning to evening, and what are the food habits from them. So 11 to 13 years, they will be around 5th to 6th standard. Mothers will feed them, right? Spoon feeding. So whereas 17 to 19 years children, they'll be completing their school and entering for undergraduate degree programs. So they'll be very independent. The research question asked dietary intake of adolescents. So when you study together from 11 years to 19 years together as a one cohort, you will get a lot of variation. You will get a lot of diversity. So this kind of scenario, this kind of situation, this kind of study, you can narrow down your subjects into this age group. Can we ask the dietary intake of 11 to 13 years? Shall we go for 14 to 16 years and 17 to 18, 19 years? With that, you collect the information. With that, we can go and propose and write the report. So this will give you more meaningful information than putting them together, 11 to 19 years together as a one cohort, one group, will give different pictures, different scenario. Okay, so separate them like this, you have some kind of meaningful information for your interpretation. So cluster sampling, actually, cluster is nothing but divide the population into section, divide the whole Tamil Nadu into district, right? Nowadays, we used to get a lot of news, right? The prevalence of COVID-19 in different district-wise, area-wise, cluster sampling, right? So area-wise, you study about the prevalence. Area wise, you study about the land value. The area wise, district wise, you study about the student graduation, graduates, number of graduates in each state. Number of graduates in each state or each district or number of educational institution in each district in Tamil Nadu. Number of educational institute in Tamil Nadu, different districts. All right. Or you study about the land value in whole Tamil Nadu. So the whole Tamil Nadu, we need to split them into different districts. Right. So with that, you select some district and study, etc. So this kind of scenario, you proceed with different type of sampling. So type of sampling also very, very important. We need to spell out what type of sampling method you have used in your survey, in your study, etc. Okay. So then we move on with. So there are two different type of research normally we do. One is observational study. Another one is called experimental study. Observational study, usually statisticians are looking for answers to questions like this. Smoking causes lung cancer. Does a new AP stat book provide better AP exam results? Does a new statistics book provide a better performance? Does a particular medication reduce the heart rate, pulse rate? So these kind of questions normally we ask, and we answer questions like this in two ways: through observational studies or by conducting the experiment. Right. So tell me, which one has got observational study, which one has got experiment? Which one has got? There are three hypotheses I have given you, three scenario I have given you. Which question you follow descriptive, which question it comes under experimental? Do you smoke, yes or no? Or whether he has got lung cancer? It's observational. You record this
history from the
observational. So does AP statistics books provide a better AP exam results? Does new
experiment,
for example, those students are studying this particular statistics book, another group of students, they study another textbook, and then you look at the performance. Okay. Right. And does a particular medication reduce the pulse rate? For example, you have two types of drug meant for reducing the pulse rate, or you are
experiment.
Okay. So observation means we observe the individual and measure the variables of interest, but does not attempt to influence their responses. We do not influence the responses. Okay. Experiment means we deliberately imposes some treatment on individuals in order to observe the responses. Experiment means we conduct the laboratory condition. We modify, we adjust something, and then we observe under the performance on effect of independent variable on dependent variable. Yeah. So field study, your survey related studies, all comes under observational. Okay. Field studies, observational studies, consumer perception, attitude, knowledge related is called observational study. Just you give them, then you observe the performances. Observe the knowledge, collect the satisfaction, etc. Experiment, we conduct them in the laboratory condition. We manipulate some variable and we keep the environment constant, homogeneous, then we observe the response variable. So there are different types of observational studies: case series, cross-sectional, retrospective, and prospective. Case series means, for example, so there are 100 people in the diabetic ward, or 100 people admitted in a hospital having symptoms of COVID-19. So you study about their history. When they have got, what are the symptoms they have? Case series. Only look at a particular COVID-19 infected cases you study. With that, you come up with a report, case report. Cross-sectional, cross-sectional actually is example to study about the dietary intake of students. Cross-sectional, right? A cohort. Or you do in a fishing pond or in a river, you collect fish species. You do fishing net, right? With that, what are the fish species are available in the river or in the lake? Cross-sectional. Or you go to the forest, you look at what are the plant species are available in the forest, etc. Cross-sectional. Retrospective and prospective is a kind of case control. Retrospective, going backward and to study why the candidate has got the disease. For example, someone has got cancer, admitted in the hospital, right? Then you look forward, look backward to see why the candidate has got cancer. Whether has got the candidate has got any smoking habit, or whether the candidate was working in a kind of any kind of factories, they do release chemicals. Retrospective, going backward to study the reason or cause for the death, cause for the disease. Retrospective. Prospective means going forward and study. Going forward and study, cohort study. Meaning to say that you have 200 people, 100 people working in a university, 100 people working in a kind of, there is a one industry, normally that releases toxic chemicals, Sterlite industry in Thoothukudi, let's say. So among this, you follow up for the people, people working in a university, people working in a chemical industries. How many they do develop a lung infection or respiratory illness, respiratory disorder? You see, even do you think you know people working in a university will not get a lung cancer? There will be, they also will get. But the chances for people working in a chemical factory, chemical industry, there will be a more. So this kind of cases, who will develop more? How much there is an increase in the death or increase in the cases in the people working in the chemical factories? It's called prospecting, going forward and study. Okay. So I've given you the elaborate discussion in the next slide. You can look at here. So what can observational studies tell us? Observational studies can find the relationship between the variables and also identify the trend, but cannot show cause and effect. Cannot show cause and effect. Let's say you collect the data for 100 companies, and the 100 companies, how much money you have spent for advertisement, and how much was your sales? What was your sales? We can observe and we can study the relationship. How the advertisement money spent for promotion and towards the sales or revenue. We can study the relationship. Is there any positive relationship or any negative relationship? For example, an observant study may find that students using our new textbook get better exam results, but it cannot show that this inferred difference is due to the book, and there may be other factors. So to show cause and effect, we need to do a careful, controlled experiment. So this is ideal, but not always practical, especially when dealing with the people. So experiment will give you good evidence, cause. So in order for an investigation to be considered an experiment, we must do something to influence our subjects. One group, we give the drug, another group, you don't give the drug, then you see the differences. Okay. So there are two important elements need to consider when we plan our experiment. One is called design must include random assignment, two or more groups, and then to do a comparison of the two groups. How a people has given a drug is better than the control, right? How much difference is there between two groups? Okay, so let's say I have we have two type of teaching methodology. One is online methodology, another one is a face-to-face. So nowadays we have been habituated with online, and many of my students, they prefer online, right? And also they feel much interesting as well. But there are some group of people, they don't prefer online. So I'm going to compare two type of teaching methodology. Let's say example, I have 200 biotech students. Among them, the student knowledge, they are not equal. There are 40 high IQ students based on the previous semester results or based on their attitude or activity. I go for 40 high IQ students. 100 average students and 40 low IQ students. So from the students, I'm going to select 30 students for each group. And each group, again, I randomly split into two groups, group A, group B, etc. For each 30, I split into group A and group B, this 30 A into group A and group B. So what I do, I will ask those who are in the A group, they all can go together, and those who are in the B group, they all can go together. And then the group A, I give online teaching. Group B, I give them face-to-face teaching. And after having this mode of teaching, I will assess them in the future. So which treatment is effective, whether online teaching is effective or face-to-face teaching is effective. So here there are two principles are involved, random selection and the random assignment. The 30 I have chosen from the 40 is a randomly I have chosen without any bias. From the 120, I have chosen 30 randomly. This is called random selection. And then splitting them into 15-15 in these two groups, also I have assigned them randomly, right? So we have to assign them randomly. Otherwise, what if you tell them that, so if you ask them 15 students go to group A, 15 students go to group B, means even sometimes all the best students may go to this group, right? So you have to do random assignment. As a researcher, we have to do random assignment. Okay, yeah. So these are the vocabulary. As a researcher, we must know with reference to experiments. Factor, level, response variable, experimental units, subject or participants, treatment, etc. So these are the variable when you perform experiment, we supposed to know. Factor means explanatory variable, your independent variable. How many independent variable you have in your study, explanatory variable. And then level means in each independent variable, how many levels you have it, how many levels you have it, right? And then response variable actually is your outcome variable. You measure the outcome variable. Experimental units means the subjects or animals you used for the study, or when you are comparing the student will be the experimental unit, right? Subjects or participants. So individual on each, on which the experiment is done is called experimental units. So treatment, a specific combination of levels from all factors that an experimental group will be receiving. For example, effect of temperature on the hatching rate of fish egg. So factor actually is the temperature. The level means I go with the different temperature levels, 25 degrees Celsius, 30 degrees Celsius, 32 degrees Celsius, 40 degrees Celsius, the different levels. Response variable, the hatching rate. Okay, so temperature actually is independent variable. The response variable actually is the dependent variable. So let's say I want to compare two common blood pressure medicines, or two common drugs are used for reducing the blood pressure. So let's say these are the medicines are available for controlling the blood pressure, cortisol and Lutensin. So which is more effective? So how we can conduct the study? So what I do, I plan to randomly assign 50 high blood pressure patient to the first drug, another 50 to receive them the second drug. So after 30 days, I will compare the change in the patient blood pressure. So with that, I can see how much, which drug is good, reducing the blood pressure. So now you tell me what is the factor, what is the level and response variable, experimental units and treatment. So factor means the different types of drugs. Level means I have two levels, cortisol and Lutensin. So this is factor actually is my independent variable. And the independent variable has got two levels. Cortisol one group and Lutensin one group, control group and treatment group, etc. Response variable, high blood pressure. Experimental units, high blood pressure candidate. Experimental units, I have recruited high blood pressure candidate subjects, patients. And then treatment means I have group one and group two. Group one, I give them cortisol and group two, I give them Lutensin. Okay, so this is called group one and group two. This is called treatment. So these are all vocabulary. As a researcher, being a biological researcher, we supposed to know, or if you are teaching, we need to know these all vocabulary with reference to experiment. So I give one more example. Suppose I am interested to prepare a perfect pound cake. I am planning to go for preparing a cake. Okay. And then I plan to test three different baking methods. These are the Fahrenheit, 325 Fahrenheit degree Celsius, Fahrenheit, 375 and 425 degree Fahrenheit. And then I'm going to go for two methods. One is for glass method, another one is for metal. And with that, I'm going to prepare 24 cakes and I'm going to see the performance from my family members. How do they taste the cake? So now you tell me, what is your factor, what is your treatment, what is the response variable, etc. See here, factor means temperature and fan type. I have two factor. In temperature, I have different levels. Fan type, I have two, glass and metal. Levels, I have a temperature, different levels. Pan, I have glass pan and metal pan. Responsive variable, the taste given by my family members. The taste given by maybe 1 to 10, the taste, or 1 to 100. Experimental units, cake, which I'm going to prepare. Treatment, there are six treatment. Okay, treatment, there are six treatment. 325 degree in glass, 375 degree in glass, 420 in glass, 325 in metal, 375 in metal, and 425 in metal. Okay, so I've given you the examples of experimental designs. So there are three important principles when you do experiment we need to remember: control, randomization, replication. Control means limit the effect of lurking variables on the response. How a particular drug is better than the baseline. How a particular group is higher than the control. How much difference is there? How effect your new drug is when compared to other drug. So then randomization, to avoid the chance error, assigning the 50-50 students to group, we have to give them randomly. If not, the chance will influence your outcome. Okay, randomization. Replication, we need to repeat the experiment many times to get confirm the results. Use many subjects within one experiment or repeat the experiment many times on different group of subjects. Let's say here, reconsider the blood pressure medication experiment we have discussed above. Control means I have two groups, right? As much as possible, I kept them under the same condition, right? 50-50 high blood pressure candidate, I had it. I split them 50 for control group and 50 for experimental group. Randomization, I assign them randomly. Even sometimes you can blind them. The participants, they do not know whether they are receiving drug A or drug B. Blinding, right? And replication means we have used 100 subjects in the experiment and each group we have got 50 patients, high blood pressure patients. Replication, we have repeated the study, conducted the study in 50 people, replications. Repeating the study, right? Replication. So then we move on with the statistical method, right? There are two types of statistics: descriptive statistics and inferential statistics. Descriptive statistics is meant for summarize, comparing the mean and proportion in inferential statistics. So descriptive statistics is meant for describing. Inferential statistics is meant for comparing the mean, proportion, or comparing with the control and treatment group. How effective your new drug, or how best your drug compared to the other drug available in the market. How effective your new teaching methodology compared to the traditional mode of teaching methodology, etc. So descriptive statistics, we go for displaying the data using a graphical and also descriptive statistical measure like mean, median, mode, correlation, and visualizing the data using the different graphical procedure like histogram, frequency, and scatterplot example. Inferential statistics, we do sample, with that we go for interpretation or interpolation for study about the population, right? Inferential statistics, we try to infer information from a population using sample. So then we move on with the table and graph. So when you go for a table and graph, we need to follow some kind of cardinal rules, right? So I used to receive a lot of theses for evaluation from different universities in India, right? So even PhD students, they do commit mistakes. Even PhD students, they do commit mistakes. Even there is a slight mistakes will give a different impression on the reviewer. Okay. So when undergraduate students, they do mistake, acceptable. When PhD students do, cannot accept. Right? Yeah. So PhD actually is a very tertiary education. So graph actually is meant for, it's a mathematical picture. Graph actually is a mathematical picture. Used to show the and present the qualitative trend and a large amount of data. Table men comes with columns and rows. So these are the principle we need to follow. Table means every table should have a clear title, concise and adequate title. The title should have a distinct number, right? And the title should reflect what information you are given in the table. So table and graph is a self-explanatory. Abbreviation should be avoided to the extent as possible. If there is no other way, you have to spell out what is your abbreviation, right? And then each table you present normally a lot of variables. Each table you present with a lot of variables. Variables comes with the different units. Some with, for example, you are measuring the height and weight. So height measured in centimeter, weight measured in kilogram, right? And the family income also you record. So each variable comes with a different unit. So you have to specify your height you measured in centimeter, or your body weight measured in kilogram or in gram. So each column, the unit of measurement, compulsory you have to specify. See here, this is an example of table. So table number is the table heading is the. Also they have interpreted the results also inside, and they have classified the table into columns and rows. Is that easy? So this is the way the table should be organized. The table should be organized and also more very simple form. And you have to follow the table instruction based on the instruction given by the authors for the respective journal. Okay, so tabulation, the heading and which is vary from journal to journal in different disciplines. Okay, so this is another table. And later I will pass these slides to Dr. Maithili and Dr. Rajalakshmi, the organizer of this event, and they will give it to you. Okay, you can refer this. So graphical means the title comes in the bottom. The top title comes in the bottom, and you have to have a figure number, and the labeling also very, very important. Labeling also very important in the graph. So when you have a set of data, normally we look at this property, right? When you collect some data, let's say we have 100 participants in this class, in this session. So I will ask what is the age of participants? 100 participants, I collect only the age, right? And with that, I will have one figure. What is the average center of, right, the age? And then I also ask for how much differences is there? Variation, minimum to the maximum. What is the maximum age group participant? What is the minimum age group participant in the session? Variation. Distribution means how the, based on age, how the participants are distributed, right? How many participants have joined with less than 30? 30 to 40, how many participants are there? 40 to 50, how many participants are there? And 50 to 60, how many participants are there? Is there any participants from 60, right? So I go with the distribution. So when you have a set of data, normally we look at this property. And then we also look at, is there any extreme case? Is there any participant less than 20 years? Is there any participant more than 75 years attending this session? Outlier, right? Outlier means extreme unusual value, unusual value. Meaning to say that majority of the participants age, maybe 40 to 60, maybe one or two candidate, they may be beyond the rest of the observation. So those data is called outlier. Those observation is called outlier. Is that fine? Okay. So then we move on with the descriptive statistics. So there are two type of measure. One is a measure of central tendency. Another one is a measure of dispersion. Measure of central tendency is called one value will explain the whole. Right? measure of dispersion. The other value will explain how much differences is there between all the candidates. For example, I say average age of this 21 days workshop. Let's say I go with 45 plus or minus 10. So 45 actually is the age. Sorry, 45 actually age of the all the participants, 110 participants. Plus or minus 10 means the differences, deviation of age, right? So let's say I have this example, average body weight of 50 biotech students. Average body weight of 50 biotech students. It comes around 65 kg plus or minus 10 kg. So this is explaining my population, sorry, my sample, it comes from starting with 55 and maximum with 75. Okay. So this is actually the measure of central tendency. This is a measure of central tendency, and this is actually is a measure of dispersion. So this is telling how much the values are clustered, and this is giving you how much the value are dispersed, how much the value are deviated from the center. So these are the measure of central tendency, mean, median, mode. Mean means we have to sum all the value divided by the total number of observation. Median means actually is a middle value. That value separate 50% above the median and 50% below the median. Mode means most common, most frequent value in a set of observation. Okay, so this is all very, very basic. I will skip. And measure of dispersion. Measure of dispersion, we have a range, variance, standard deviation, coefficient of variation. So I'm not going to cover this formula based. Just remember what you mean by range, variance, standard deviation, and coefficient of variation. Range means you need to identify the maximum value, you need to identify the minimum value. The difference between the maximum minus minimum is called range. Variance means it's an arithmetic mean of the squared deviation from the sample mean. And this is a formula will be used. Sigma x minus x bar square divided by n minus 1 degrees of freedom. Okay. So when you take the square root for the variance, you'll get the standard deviation. No worry. No need to remember this formula. Nowadays, lot of statistical tools are available to calculate this. You need to understand when to use and how to use it, and what are the measures of dispersion need to be used for explaining your the result. Okay. So range, variance, standard deviation, and coefficient of variation. Coefficient of variation actually is whenever you have a two variable, to see which variable has got more diversity, more variation, you go for coefficient of variation. The formula for coefficient of variation is standard deviation divided by the mean times with 100. Standard deviation divided by the mean times with 100. So the outcome will be percentage coefficient of variation. Okay. So measures of dispersion, if all the values are the same, meaning to say that you have a five candidate in your class. All the five candidates you measure, the body weight is 50, 50, 50, 50, 50. So how much your standard deviation will be? So all the candidate, the body weight you measure, they're exactly 50, 50, 50, 50. Is there any dispersion? If all the values are the same, your deviation will be zero. For example, you have five candidate. You have five candidate in the class. The five candidate, one candidate weight is 45, another candidate weight is 95, another candidate is 60, another candidate is 70 and 75. So here your minimum is 45, maximum is 95. So there is a quite dispersion. There is a huge dispersion. Okay. If all the values are very close, the amount of dispersion, your standard deviation will be very, very minimum. If all the values are very far away, the dispersion are greater. The dispersion are greater. Okay. So sometimes we use standard error and standard deviation. Okay, when to use this? Usually standard error will be minimum when compared to the standard deviation. So the formula for standard deviation is this, and standard error is standard deviation divided by the square root of n. Okay, standard deviation will describe a spread of values in the sample. A spread of values in the sample. So the sample standard deviation, yes, is a random quantity. It is vary from sample to sample. Whereas standard error of the mean, and this is standard deviation of the sample means. And this describes how accurate your sample estimating the population. How accurate your sample estimating the population. I will give you an example later. Let's say here. So this is your population. Imagine that the whole circle actually is your population. Right? So from the population, you take the blue colored one are example of your observation. The blue color actually is an example of your observations. Okay. So the whole this area, we have done sampling. Let's say we have 10 candidate. The 10 candidate age you have calculated. So this comes all in one sample. This comes in one sample, right? And then you calculate the mean and standard deviation. Okay. So the differences among them is called standard deviation. And differences among them or between them is called standard deviation. This estimate the variability of the different data points within the sample. Okay. Standard error means by right, imagine that this is the whole population. With that, like this sample, you go for this many times. You go for 6 times. Each circle actually is a sample. Which circle actually is a sample? You go for different sample with same sample size. Let's say we have this group 10 sample, this group 10 observation, this 10 observation, this 10 observation, this 10 observation, this 10 observation. So now you calculate the mean for all the 6 sample. Mean for all the 6 sample, right? Then you calculate the differences. Then you calculate the differences. So the differences of all the sample means are called standard error of the mean. But right? So when you conduct the study, normally we don't go for it, but using one sample, we follow this formula to calculate the standard error of the mean. So sample standard deviation divided by your sample size, square root of the sample size, we can calculate the standard error of the mean. The standard error of the mean will explain you how precise your sample estimate predicting or estimating your population. Okay, yeah. Okay, so this is a coefficient of variation. See here. Tell me the unit, that tell me the, could you, participant, could you please put your audio mute? There are some noise disturbance. Okay, could you please put the audio mute mode? There are some noise disturbance, thank you. So here we have 2 variables. You have 50 final year medical students. You recorded the height and weight, let's say. So this is average height in centimeter, average weight in the kilogram. Standard deviation 10 centimeter, here 11 kilogram, 11.9 kilogram. So the unit for standard deviation is height centimeter, unit for weight is kilogram. This centimeter, this is a kilogram. So when you apply the coefficient of variation using this formula, the unit for coefficient of variation is percentage. So now you tell me which one has got more variation. In terms of height, weight has got more variation. 16% is a quite higher. So weight has got more variation. Weight has got more variation. So is that clear? Is that okay? Participant, can you hear me? Yeah, okay.
Yes.
So the weight has got more variation. The quantity is more. But the unit, both are in percentage. Okay. So whenever you have a couple of variables, the variables are measured in different units. You want to see the dispersion, you want to see the variation, you are recommended, you are advised to go for coefficient of variation. Coefficient of variation. Is that all right? Yeah. So then this slide is giving you, based on your nature of your data, what descriptive statistical measure can be used, what graphical illustration can be used. This is a flowchart exploring the data and explaining your data using graphically as well as descriptive statistical measure. For example, you have a categorical data. You have a categorical data. Male, female, you have some kind of category. Or you have a particular, this particular session, we have a 10 candidate from business, 10 candidate from biological sciences, and 5 candidate from mathematics, 5 from physics, categorical. So how do you go for it? We go for a proportion, we go for a percentage. So this much percentage of the male participant, this much percentage female participant, this much percentage of the participants have come from mathematics, this much have come from arts and science, and this much they have come from biological sciences, right? Frequency and percentage, you can proceed. Suppose you are dealing with collecting the age and the body weight of the 110 participants attending this session, age and the weight. Right? So in that case, you go for a mean and median. In that case, you can use median age or mean body weight or median weight. And then you can go for how you explain your variation. for continuous data, you go for a range, minimum age group and maximum age group, minimum body weight, maximum body weight, and then how much deviation is that, standard deviation. So graphical method, for categorical data, you go for a bar chart, pie chart, or clustered bar chart. Then you have a two categorical variable. Then you go for a graphical illustration, you go and go for a histogram. For example, height and weight, you can go for a histogram, you can go for a box plot, you can go for a dot plot, you can go for a scatter plot. Okay. So in the upcoming my workshop, when you join, these all you are going to practice. So if you are planning to, if you are interested to join the two workshop, maybe I have given the workshop detail to Dr. Maithili. So maybe we all can have a look at. If not, you can, if you share your email, so I will pass the content to you. So if you have interest to learn statistics more using some statistical tool, so you are most welcome. Yeah. Right. So summary of descriptive and graphical statistics. For example, if you are going to go for pie chart can be recommended for one categorical variable. The purpose to show the frequencies and proportions, percentage. The summary statistics, each class comes with percentage. Stacked or multiple or can be used for two categorical. Gender, for example, you are comparing male and female. And this pie chart can be used for example, you look at the blood group. You look at the blood group, right? A group, B group, AB group and O group. You go for a pie chart and bar chart. Right? So stacked multiple bar can be used for comparing the proportion within each group. For example, we have a male and female, and then you are also comparing with how many male wearing specs or how many female they are wearing specs. This time you have two questions. How many male and female are there among the 110 participants? Among the 110, how many male wearing specs, how many female wearing spectacles, right? So you go for a stacked and multiple bar, comparing the proportion between male and female, okay? Histogram, for example, when you are presenting your age and presenting your weight, you go for a histogram. The summary statistics, mean and standard deviation can be used for explaining your age, weight, and your income, etc. So scatter plot, let's say scatter plots can be used for, if I measure the height and weight of the 110 participants participating this session, so height of the participants, are they related with the weight? The summary statistics, coefficient of correlation or correlation coefficient. Then box plot can be used to one scale or one categorical, compare the spread of the value. You can go for comparing male and female age, or male and female cholesterol of these participants. You can go for median and interquartile range. So nowadays, very, very easy. The terminology looks very difficult, but a lot of statistical tools are available to help you to calculate the parameters. Okay. So line chart can be used for scale by type, right? For example, you can look for every day for a particular month, and the temperature. Okay, every day the temperature and ice cream sales. Every day you record, and the what you call, you can go for every day temperature, every day rainfall line chart, right? First week, second week, third week, fourth week, and the rainfall, the average temperature, etc. So then a little bit we move on with the hypothesis testing. Right, hypothesis testing actually is a claim or a statement about a population. So I never met any of your participants in this session. So I may assume that the average age of the participant will be 50. This is my gut feeling. This is my assumption. I didn't get any information from Dr. Maithili or Dr. Rajalakshmi. I assume that my guess will be 50. So how do I go? How do I test this claim? So what I do? I will ask you to say what is your age now. I will ask only 10 candidates out of 110. With that 10, I can roughly estimate the overall 110. So this is my hypothesis testing. Hypothesis testing actually is a kind of claim, a statement. Example is a court trial scene. The court trial scene, until the candidate has been proven, he is innocent. Until he has been proven, he is innocent. Okay. So hypothesis testing, otherwise known as a test of significance is a standard procedure for testing a claim or testing a statement or property of a population. Okay, so for example, a women in Coimbatore in a rural village, do they deliver normal healthy baby? So this is my research question. Do they deliver normal healthy baby in a rural village? Right, this is my question. So how do you conduct the study? In a rural village in Coimbatore, you look at the hospital, you check the newborn body weight, newborn baby weight. Whether you 100 newborn baby weight you collect, with that you check with a gold standard. Normal baby weight actually is 2.5 kg is a normal baby weight. So anything more than 2.5 is well and good. If anything less than the 100 sample you have done is lower than 2.5, then you can conclude that there is a lower baby weight, underweight children, right? So there is actually a medical complication for the child. Hypothesis testing. So this is another question I'm giving you. Is the density of fish in the flooded forest is different to the density of fish in the river mainstream? This is the research question. So let's say you have a two river system, Kaveri River and Tamarabarani River. You do study the diversity of fish in the Tamarabarani, you study the Kaveri, right? Or you study, you have two pond, or you have two group of people, you study male and female, do they have equal hemoglobin content, right? So hypothesis, so these are the claim. So there are comes with the two hypotheses, null hypothesis and alternate hypothesis. Alternate hypothesis actually is a research hypothesis. As a researcher, we are interested in alternate hypothesis. Null means there is a no difference. Null means no difference. Alternate means you as a researcher, you are trying to prove there is a difference. There is a difference. So let's say the mean monthly mobile phone bill of a university student. Let's say in Indian scenario, if a phone bill of university students, Coimbatore Bharathiyar University students, may be equal to 300. My assumption. So may be right or may not be right. And this is, my feeling is, the student nowadays, everyone, they come with a lot of Android mobile phone, everyone, right? So without mobile, we can't survive now. Without food, we can survive now, okay? So this is a habit now, we have been habituated. So without mobile, we can't survive now. So everything, so depending. So my assumption is, student, they may spend every month 300 rupees for top up. This may be right, this may be wrong. So how do you conduct the study? University students. Let's say you have 5,000 students. From the 5,000, randomly you choose 200 students or 300 students. You ask them how much money you use it for your mobile phone every month. Then you calculate the average of the 200 students. You have done the sampling. And then the average of the 200 sampling, you can compare with my assumption stated 300. Is it the sample you have done is equal to the 300 what I stated or beyond or less than that, right? So with that, you can conclude your assumption is right or your assumption is wrong. All right, yeah. So there are two way type of hypothesis, right-tailed test and left-tailed test. When you state your alternate hypothesis greater than, then you have to use a right-tailed test. When you state your alternate hypothesis less than 300 rupees, the student they are spending means, you go for left-tailed test. For example, as a researcher, if you do not know, maybe higher than 300, maybe lower than 300 rupees, they may spend for top-up for mobile phone, you go for a two-tailed test. Okay, two-tailed test example. So when you do the hypothesis testing or conducting an inferential hypothesis or any experiment, there are two type of error we may commit. They are called type 1 error and type 2 error. Type 1 error means really there is no any effect. Really there is no effect. For example, the previous example I stated that. So university student, they may spend 300 rupees. University students, they may spend for 300 rupees. So as a researcher, what do you do? What you have done? You have asked only for 10 candidate. asked for only 10 candidate. The students were sat on the cafeteria or in a canteen. You asked them. Conveniently, you had done the study. Only 5 sample you have done, and there are 10,000 students are there in your campus. Then you calculated, right? All they have given 500 rupees. Average you calculated 500 rupees, but what I stated, 300 rupees. So then you are concluding that, sir, your assumption is wrong. You are concluding that the study I have conducted, I have done only 5 sample. So average they spend more than 300. They are spending more than 300. So null hypothesis is rejected. Okay. For example, the same study, another person is going to conduct. Another person is going to conduct. The next time, the second researcher, he look for out of 10,000, he look for 500 candidate. He studied the 500 candidate. He found that 200. The average, the mobile top up, he found that or 200 or 250. So in that candidate, the first researcher has done the type 1 error. Initially, there was no effect. He has concluded that he has rejected the null hypothesis. Okay, type 1 error. Type 1 error means your drug has got no effect. You are concluding that your drug is so effect. So it's good. Do you get me? Suppose you are developing a new herbal drug for COVID-19. Okay. So just you tested for only 3 or 10 people. With that, you are concluding that my drug is so good, within 2 days, a candidate will be recovered. Can we agree this? Can we agree on this? So when you apply this in the field condition, no one recovered. Majority not recovered. So meaning to say that you have done a type 1 error. Is that right? Due to your sample size or inaccurate your sample size, you are concluding wrongly. Meaning to say that in a court trial scene, an innocent punished. He has not committed any mistake. He has not committed any mistake, but later on he has been punished. This is called type 1 error. It's a very serious error. He has not committed any mistake, but he has been punished. Do you get me? So another type of error very often we commit is called type 2 error. Type 2 error means you spend a lot of time, you spend a lot of money. Due to your sample size, you have ignored the effect. Meaning to say that your herbal drug has got really good effects on a particular disease, but you have ignored the effect. This also type 2. This is called type 2 error. Type 2 error and another scenario, for example, a candidate has committed a mistake in a court trial scene, but he has not been punished. Do you get me? He is supposed to be put in the bar or put them in the jail. He has committed a mistake, but later on he has not been given any punishment. But this is usually it happens in Indian scenario, right? Anything you can do, but you will not be punished, right? Okay. So this is called type 2 error. Type 1 error is denoted by alpha error. Type 2 error is known as a beta error. So usually the type 1 error we fix, we can also tell, we also can say that this is a significance level, 0.5, 5%, 10%, and 1%. We fix in advance as a researcher. So how much time an innocent can be punished? And 5 times an innocent can be punished out of 100. It's okay, well and good, I'm okay with. But 99 times or 95 times an innocent should not be punished. You can say that 99 times my drug will cure the case, well and good. One time my drug may not cure the candidate. It's okay. 95 times my drug cure the case. Well and good. 5 times my drug may not cure the drug. For 5% level of significance. Is that right? Yeah. So type 2 error means failure to reject the false null hypothesis. Failure to reject the false null hypothesis. False positive. So there are 2 type of statistics, parametric statistics and non-parametric statistics. So maybe another 10 minutes I'll cover up the session. Yeah, another 10 minutes. I think we have been beyond the time. So let me try and cover and wrap up the session by another 10 minutes. So I have another 10 slides to go. So there are 2 type of statistics, parametric and non-parametric statistics. Parametric means they assume some kind of shape of the population. Meaning to say that the data should follow the normally distributed. The data should follow the normally distributed. When you want to go for a parametric statistical method, you have to see some of the assumptions. You have to see some of the assumption regarding your experimental or data, right? Parametric statistical data. Non-parametric means you can have any type of data, any type of distribution. You can proceed with non-parametric statistical method. Hence, the non-parametric statistical methods are called distribution-free statistical test. Non-parametric statistical methods are called distribution-free statistical test. Example of parametric test procedure, which involve the population parameter and also have a stringent assumption, for example, normality. Examples of parametric test are called t-test, Pearson correlation, ANOVA, two-way ANOVA are examples of parametric. Remember, each parametric statistical method, there is an alternate non-parametric statistical procedure or test. So assumption can be tested. For example, if you are going to go for a t-test, ANOVA, regression, correlation, we need to check for the assumption. How we can check for the assumption? Number of statistical tools are available. Statistical approach and graphical approach. Statistical approach, you do the histogram like this. Or you can go for kind of QQ plot. So whenever you have this kind of distribution, the data is not ideal for parametric statistical method. You will see this kind of skewed data. That somewhat your tail has got very skewed toward the positive end. So this kind of data, you cannot go for a parametric statistical method. Suppose you have like this. This looks like a normal. This looks like a normal. The values are closer to the line. So this is called normal QQ plot. So these are the observations of SPSS outcome. These are observations of SPSS outcome. And most of the time, we have to look for the assumption whether your data met for conducting the parametric statistical method or whether the data do follow the condition before we go for a parametric statistical method. Okay. And then statistical approach for normality, we have a histogram. In addition to that, there are a couple of statistical tests like Shapiro-Wilk test, Kolmogorov-Smirnov test can be used to study about the normality assumption. Okay. Yeah. So non-parametric test procedure do not involve any population parameter. Any distribution is okay. The data can be measured in any scale, ratio, interval, ordinal, nominal, well and good. You can proceed with the non-parametric statistical method. Another condition, when you are dealing with the ranked data or ordinal data, your non-parametric is the only option you have to proceed with. Or another condition, if there is a definite outlier, you have extreme value in your data you have collected, then you have to go for non-parametric test procedure. Example, Wilcoxon rank sum test, Kriskal-Wallis, etc. Right. So these are the commonly used statistical method. These are the commonly used statistical method. If you understand this, well and good. Right. So my upcoming workshop, I will be covering dealing with all these statistical tests with hands-on exercise, with practical hands-on exercise, right, for in different field. One sample t-test for comparing with the gold standard. I told you, right, one example, birth weight of a newborn baby in a particular locality. Do they deliver normal baby or not? Comparing with the gold standard. Another example, you purchase a water bottle from a supermarket. The water bottle, they specified that 500 ml. Do you think exactly 500 ml will be there? If 95 times 500 ml is there, as a customer, you are okay. 95 times lower than the 500 ml means we have been cheated. Okay, so comparing with the gold standard, we go for a one sample t-test. Comparing male and female hemoglobin content for parametric test, we go for an independent sample t-test. If the data does not follow normality, we go for a Mann-Whitney or Wilcoxon rank sum test. So the purpose to compare two independent sample, apple versus orange, market value. Right, a control group and treatment group, is there any difference? Our customer in Chennai, customer from Tirunelveli, do they have a similar behavior on towards a particular product? Paired t-test, you have a new drug, the drug is effective or not, before and after. Studying the same behavior, before advertisement and after advertisement, the sales improvement for the particular product, right? So regarding the soap or any kind of consumable product, before advertisement and after advertisement, is there any kind of improvement is there? Or before training and after training, is there any knowledge improvement in there? For example, you have been attending for the last 21 days. We can assess the research methodology. We can assess your skills, soft skills you have gained for the last 21 days. So before joining the workshop, we assess your knowledge. And after completion of your 21 days, we can assess your knowledge on a particular topic. So paired t-test, right? If follow normality, we go for paired. If does not follow normal assumption, we have to go for equivalent non-parametric Wilcoxon rank sum test. Okay. So comparing the relationship of age and age of 110 participants and weight or age versus systolic blood pressure, we go for a Pearson correlation. To assess the linear relationship between the two variables, we go for relationship studies. Okay. For example, you are comparing three groups, mean value, comparing A, B, and C. And comparing more than three groups, we go for a analysis of variance. Let's say you have two independent variable, one dependent variable. We go for a parametric, we go for a two-way ANOVA. In non-parametric, we go for a Friedman two-way analysis of variance. Okay. So these are all additional reference. You can use it for your reference. And the last slide I come up with. So statistical software. Nowadays, we have a lot of statistical tools are available. Some are very free, some are very highly expensive. The tools like Microsoft Excel, so friendly and user-friendly, very easy to format your output, and very easily you can do lot of statistical analysis. For teaching purpose, I would say Microsoft Excel actually is a very interesting, very easy tool. You can convince any students. So I have been using a Microsoft Excel and SPSS for teaching my student for biostatistics and research methodology. Okay, so Microsoft Excel and SPSS. And another software is called PSPP. SPSS actually is a paid one. PSPP actually is a free one. And there is another program called SAS, Stata, R Statistics, MATLAB, Crapad, Prism, and Minitab. So these all softwares are available for data analysis. Okay. So if you are very good or if you are master in any one particular software, so that will serve your purpose. Okay. So with that, I have come to the end of the session. I hope you would have gained some statistical knowledge. So if you have any queries, any questions, you are most welcome. You are most welcome. You can contact me. You can contact me. So I will leave this contact details. Participant, I leave this contact email. So if you are looking for any kind of data analysis services or any kind of seeking for help, and would you like to participate the workshop, you are most welcome. Okay, so you can contact me this WhatsApp number, or you can use this email ID for any communication. Okay, so with that, thank you so much for the participant. Participant, could you please put mute in your audio? So thank you so much, Dr. Maithili and Dr. Jayalakshmi, for giving this great opportunity. So if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer. Participant, yeah.
Participants, you can ask for a few minutes. Yes, Ms. Yes, Dr.
Any questions?
Sir, regarding the sample size calculation.
Sir, yes, sir. I have one question, sir. Sir, I want to.
Sir. Yes. Tell me, ma'am.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. You can ask.
Sir,
me.
I want to ask one question. Sir, for convenience sample. Sir, for convenience sampling, sir, I want to conduct one survey on urban forestry in my area, sir. And okay. I have to find out the number of species these people are doing. Sir, what would be the appropriate respondent size, sample size, sir, for this kind of survey, sir?
Ma'am, your audio is breaking. Hello? I couldn't hear you completely.
Sir.
I couldn't hear you completely, ma'am. Can
sir,
you
my question
me? It's not clear, ma'am.
Sir, can I repeat it again, sir?
Yeah, you can repeat.
So the question is, sir, for convenience sampling, sir, for convenience sampling, what would be the appropriate sample size for respondents, sir, for online survey?
Ma'am, usually traditional way, you can go for number of questions you have in your survey. Each questions, for example, you have 10 questions, traditional approach. Okay, each question you have to have 10 responses minimum.
Sir, yes.
Okay, each question, for example, you have 10 question means 100 participants. This is one approach. Another approach, you need to refer your previous study, similar study. And then based on the previous study statistics, you can calculate sample size. Based on the previous study, you can calculate the sample size. With that, you can proceed. There are number of statistical tools are available to study about the sample size. Okay, can you please take note the software called GPower? Okay, can you please take note the software, free software for calculating the sample size for any study, GPower sample size. It's a free one.
GPower.
Okay, can you ask? GPower. Okay. Yeah, any other questions?
Good afternoon, sir. I'm Mrs. Rita Madan.
So my question is
Could you please ask one by one? There is audio disturbance.
Okay. Should I ask?
Yeah, please, ma'am. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm Mrs. Madan from Mathematics Department. Sir, my topic is to find a new method to solve AP and this TP, transportation. So once we develop a new method, then how to collect the data? Means for the other theoretical subject, they have some method like questionnaire or something. But in this case, how to collect the data?
Could you please tell me your study? To
develop a new method to solve assignment problem and transportation problem. So if I develop another method, then how to collect the data for the further step?
So first of all, you need to design your method. How many methods you are going to compare?
Okay.
And then your comparison, you are going to compare with the three different methods or four different methods, let's say.
Okay.
So which method is good? That is what your question, right? Based on your nature of your data, you can come up with the appropriate statistics like ANOVA. You are dealing with continuous data, ratio data, you go for ANOVA. If not, non-parametric, Kriskal-Wallis. If it is ordinal data, you go for a Kriskal-Wallis.
So for ordinal, can you repeat?
Ordinal, you go with the Kriskal-Wallis, comparing more than two groups, more than two method.
Criss-cross. Okay.
Kriskal-Wallis. All right.
Okay.
Yeah. If anything, you can call me. You can email me. Data analysis, I'll help you. Yeah.
Yeah.
Send me your objectives and also your nature of your study. So I'll help you to go for appropriate statistical method. Yeah.
Oh, thank you so much, sir. Good to see you.
Yeah. Keep in touch. Thank you. Any other questions? One more question, if I'm okay with. So if not, I will give
sir,
the floor.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Sir, you told that do you calculate the sample size calculation to use the software, GPower.
Yeah.
Sir, apart from that, we have some formula for the sample size calculation. So can I get some information about that, sir? How to?
You can use any tool, ma'am. You can use any sample size tool, but in your methodology, writing your thesis, writing your manuscript, you have to be very transparent. So in what way, how tool you have used for sample size and what measurement you have used for calculating your sample size. You have to be very transparent. No issue. You can use any tool, any software.
Okay, so there is some formulas there, no sir, for the sample size kernel.
So based on your proportion, based on your mean, based on your coefficient, based on the formula, you can use it.
Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Maybe normally we calculate margin of error. Your mean, we calculate the sample.
Okay, sir.
There is a noise disturbance.
Hello.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yeah.
I have a question, sir.
Yeah, please ask me, sir.
Hello.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Actually, is it advisable to apply more than one tool for a same problem, for the same problem?
For what purpose, sir? For sample size calculation or for any kind of data analysis?
For optimization problem, because suppose I have used suppose one tool, got some result, again by said to verify it, again by another tool. So is it?
But most of the descriptive statistical measure in different tool will be similar, sir. But my advice is use only one tool.
Sir,
Your objective is to compare the two tool means you go for comparison. Same data using for different statistical tool is not advisable. You can use any one thing. For example, some observation can be used Microsoft Excel. Yeah. Some can be used for
using sir, I've seen people using this ANOVA. Again, they are verifying with fuzzy logic type of thing. So is it good?
Nature of the study, sir, can be used actually. Some analysis, SPSS can be used. Some analysis you can go for R statistics. Some you can go for SAS. No problem, you can use it. But nature of your study. But same hypothesis should not be tested with the same data, should not be tested with different statistical tool. For example, you're conducting ANOVA. No need to go for ANOVA conducting using Excel and SPSS. Okay. For example, you have done a study, frequency analysis can be Excel, can be used. For ANOVA and post hoc, SPSS can be used or R statistics can be used. Okay. Same results should not be presented with this different statistical tool. So kind of redundant. Redundant. But if there is a way, you have to justify why you are using it. That's it. Is that all right?
I will be in contact with you, sir.
Yeah,
I'll
please.
Be in contact with you, sir.
Okay. Yeah, keep in touch. Keep in touch.
My name is Shankar.
From which institute? Which university, sir? Shankar? Dr. Shankar?
Sir, Central Agricultural University. Shankar Das, Central Agricultural University.
All right, sir. All right. Thank you. Yeah, keep in touch. Is it okay, Dr. Maithili? Shall I?
Yes,
conclude?
Sir.
Yeah, yes, shall sir. I conclude? Yeah.
Yes, sir. We can conclude the same things. Yes.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thanks so much for your eminent talk on this application of statistics in research. Thank you. It's a really wonderful session.
Yeah, thank you.
Dr. Anil Kumar, I could just connected with him, madam. last question.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, sir, a small question and the basic aspect. You know, I'd like to know, I have a confusion that what should be the minimum size for application of statistical tools, sir? Let it be any softwares or any methods. And as far as the population size is concerned.
Okay, so actually the sample sizes vary from nature of your study, sir. Each study, your sample size will be vary. For example, when you're using with the animal model, comparing the drug efficacy.
Okay, sir.
Normally, we advise 6 minimum.
Okay. But if it is a in a crop evaluation studies, if you are comparing the varieties and several parameters, sir.
Then you have to calculate your appropriate sample size, sir. How much differences you are expecting from fertilizer 1 to fertilizer 2. You have to calculate based on the mean value and the deviation, you have to calculate the sample size. What is the appropriate sample size? So sample size is vary from your nature of your study and the type of variable you are dealing with. Yeah, that is vary, sir. Vary from nature of your study. We cannot say anything. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, participants. You have the speaker's contact address. So you can contact further for any queries related to your study. He will assist you. So it's now time to wind up the session. Sir, I thank my heartfelt thanks to Dr. Marimuthu, sir, for his eminent presence today. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Participants can stay back for the seminar session.